So when I was 10 or 11 years old, I formed a band with my brother and sister, Toby and Polly. This is like 1979. And we were a sort of DIY, homespun, post-punk band called The Hippies, with the intended irony. And our mum, Ruth, was our kind of manager, Svengali, which makes it, you know, that makes it sound like a professional operation, but really we were just kicking around at home in the holidays, and she got fed up with us dossing around and said, could you do something? Why don't, come on, guys, do something creative, like form a band. I mean, some parents may have said, go out and play football or, you know, read a book. But for her, she was really into music at that point, and she said, you know, form a band, that would be cool. And so we did. And that's the sort of heart of the story, if you like. And we produced a cassette called A Sound for the Future, which had four or five songs on it. And yeah, so that was the kind of heart of the story. But the way that I make films is from a kind of artist angle, if you like. And so I see the cassette, the memories, the anecdotes from my family as the material to, you know, sort of randomly generated materials, if you like, that I then stitch together as a filmmaker, to not so much tell a story, but give the audience a kind of immersive experience of what I'm getting at. So the film is this intense kaleidoscopic patchwork of impressions and memories and attempts at trying to get to some sense of the truth of that time, if that makes any sense. But actually, you know, the reason I make films is some of these things are really hard to articulate other than through making the film itself. So if I've done my job, then the film should answer most of the sort of questions around what is the story and how is he telling it, you know? Because there is actually no... I mean, what's interesting, because some of the reviews and previews that have come up mention this archival material. In fact, we had no archival moving image anyway of the band. We just had this one photograph, which features in the... You know, that becomes the kind of icon throughout the film, these three kids, the hippies. and then a few other family photos, obviously the cassette. But apart from that, we had very little archive stuff, which presented a creative challenge. How do you tell a story about this band without those materials, plus also the fact that one of the band members is reluctant to be involved in the film at all? So, you know, that gave me quite a lot to work around, creative hurdles, you could say. So yes, that may be partly the reason why it has this patchwork quality, as I was obliged to go through all these processes and hoops to sort of bring the story back together. So yes, we're also the three key songs by the Hippies are in the film as standalone animated sort of pop animated sequences. And that was work made working in collaboration with a collage artist called Jean McEwen. So she did the artwork, and then the editor, you know, created movement from those pieces. And my input there was to suggest what kind of material she should collage from. What else have we got? We've got a government information advert there about warning about the dangers of rabies. So that's archival from, you know, 1977, 78 or something. There's various songs that I perform that kind of explode on the screen as like little pop videos that I use to discuss certain aspects of what's happening in the film. Rather than having the kind of narrator, the voiceover, I narrate through song largely. And that has its own kind of energy. We use a lot of Super 8 cine film, which has its own texture, and we reveal that texture quite clearly on screen and show that it's, you know, this physical medium. And then, yes, then we also have five sets of kids in groups of three going through the process of becoming the hippies over time. So that's sort of fly on the wall doc style. You watch that development. And then there's, as you said, there's also the more dramatic fictional scenes, which are the recreations of my memories of certain incidences from around that time that may have led to who I am now. So there's a kind of bit of psychological exploration as well of myself. I've been at pains to make a clear distinction actually between punk and post-punk, because I mean, when the Pistols exploded in that famous, you know, Free Trade Hall concert where hundreds of people claimed to have been there, you know, it was like this, it was a flash in the pan, but a massive flash in the pan that had these repercussions that we still feel today. But, you know, I was far too young to have been involved in that, and I kind of vaguely remember there being a band with a slightly rude name, you know. But it wasn't until the late, sort of 1979, so 3 years, full 3 years after that explosion of the Sex Pistols, that I started to engage with music, as was my mum at that time. So this would have been, you know, the post-punk wave, the new wave, which is very different from in spirit and style and ambition from what the Pistols were up to, because the Pistols are really a kind of nihilistic, situationist prank of Malcolm McLaren's, where he used those lads to kind of, you know, make his point. So that was a message coming from a much an older guy, a sort of ex-hippie, if you like, anarchist. And what we were exposed to in the post-punk bit was, I don't know, Ian Dury, and the humour of Ian Dury, the intelligence of early Talking Heads, the humour in a band like XTC, I mean, all sorts of things that were kind of, they had this, I think the underlying things, they had this kind of quirky humour, and the ethos, I suppose, was that everyone always talks about, is that you felt like you could have a go at this yourself, and it was allowed, and that we were a direct result of that ethos in the UK, where it was like anyone can make a band, you know. I would, to be completely honest, underlying everything, I'm trying to make a point about filmmaking. So regardless of the subject, I you know, it's really what my personal ambition is to make a statement about a way of working that's I have been occasionally frustrated in trying to get my work made because of what I see as the conventions and the standard processes that you need to go through to get support or finance, which usually comes from the script. So it's literary focused approach to making what is essentially moving image and sound and poetry. And I find that, you know, so I'm in a bit of a campaign, personal artistic campaign there to try and make an impact. And I feel like I finally had some impact with experimented fishing it out and saying, actually, this is a really interesting and different way of making films, but it's not obscure or so arty that you feel excluded from it, or, you know, it's got warmth, it's got humor. Art can be humorous and warm and loving as well as strange and dark, and I think that's sort of quite a post-punk position in a way.